The next disorder of the esophagus is going to be Barrett's esophagus. Now, I hope you can recall that when we were discussing the very first chapter of pathology, of general pathology, we did something in cell injury that was cellular adaptations. And I hope you can recall that cellular adaptations had a very important adaptation, the fourth number that we did, that was metaplasia, where one epithelium was changing into another epithelium, and that is where we did something called as Barrett's esophagus. So now we are going to recap most of the things that you've done over there. We're just going to repeat it once over here with a few things that we are going to add on more. So first and foremost, what is Barrett's esophagus? It is basically a metaplastic process. It is going to be a metaplastic process, number one. And as you remember, two things about metaplasia. That is, one, it is reversible. One, it is reversible. Remember, this was one of the most important questions and MCQs about metaplasia. It is reversible. And number two, it is when one epithelium, so in this case, which epithelium? The normal epithelium of the esophagus is the squamous epithelium. When the squamous epithelium of the esophagus is going to convert into the intestinal columnar epithelium, is going to convert into the intestinal columnar epithelium. And I hope you remember very clearly that this is the epithelium that has something known as goblet cells. Something known as goblet cells, the most important feature of an intestinal columnar epithelium. What defines an intestinal epithelium is the goblet cell. So squamous epithelium of the esophagus gets converted into the intestinal type of columnar epithelium. And why did this change occur? This has happened because of GERD, gastroesophageal reflux disease. So what is happening is when a lot of acid is going from the stomach back into the esophagus, there is a reflux that is happening. How is the esophagus protecting itself? The esophagus is saying that I will convert my squamous epithelium into an intestinal type of epithelium so that I can protect myself from this acid damage that is constantly happening to me. So why is this gastroesophageal reflux disease happening? What are the causes of gastroesophageal reflux disease? So remember, number one is what I think everyone has experienced following overeating. So following overeating, maybe at night time, during sleep time, you do feel at times that there is a regurgitation that happens. That is actually gastroesophageal reflux disease. I think each and every one of us has experienced that. Other than that, it can also be associated because of alcohol intake. It is also associated in smokers. It is also seen in smokers. Following this, it is also seen in those individuals who are going to be obese, so obese people, and also in pregnant females. Now, why is it seen in pregnancy? So you know that if something has to go from the stomach into the esophagus, backflow, the back word regurgitation, there is a sphincter that is present over here. So if this is the esophagus and this is the stomach, so you do know that over here there is a lower esophageal sphincter. Till the time this lower esophageal sphincter does not open or does not relax, nothing can go back. So this is because of relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter. When it relaxes, the contents are going to go back. So why in pregnancy? Number one, yes, the intra-abdominal pressure is so much increased in a pregnant woman during the third trimester towards the end that this can happen. Agreed. Same way as in obese people, that when the intra-abdominal pressure is increased, the sphincter relaxes. But in pregnant women, this can also be seen in the early parts of pregnancy, in the early phase of pregnancy, when probably the intra-abdominal pressure is not very much raised. Why? Because remember that progesterone relaxes the lower esophageal sphincter. So that is a very important point that you note over here, and do correlate this when you go and do the effects of pregnancy on the female body in obstetrics. So progesterone hormone, and we know pregnancy is a progesterone rich state, a progesterone predominant state. So this progesterone will relax the lower esophageal sphincter. That is why the pregnant women always come with a complaint of repetitive reflux, regurgitation. And now, as we've said, because of all these causes in these patients, one epithelium, that is the squamous epithelium, will change into the intestinal type of columnar epithelium. Now, what are the questions that you need to know over here? If you are put up a question that how will you do the diagnosis of Barrett's esophagus? So remember, for the diagnosis of Barrett's esophagus, you will always have to do a biopsy. And what will you see on the biopsy? Now keep in mind, what was it? Squamous epithelium changing into intestinal columnar epithelium. So with this, you will have to now identify the image. So on a biopsy, if you see over here, and if you divide this particular image into two parts, there is one part over here, one type of epithelium, and there is one type of epithelium that is clearly over here. So I divided the image into two parts. Remember the image, the part that you see over here, this is the squamous epithelium. This is the squamous epithelium. And over here, can you easily appreciate this glandular pattern? You can see glands present over here. So whenever we have this glandular pattern, this is something that we see in the intestinal columnar epithelium. So the gland pattern, this is the intestinal columnar epithelium. And what was I saying? That the intestinal columnar epithelium is going to contain which cells? Correct, the goblet cells. So if we zoom into this image, you can clearly see that over here we have lots of goblet cells present. All these vacuoles that are present, these are the goblet cells. What do these vacuoles contain? What do these round spaces contain? They contain mucin. So remember, why are we particularly calling it intestinal columnar epithelium? Because it has goblet cells. And goblet cells are nothing but filled with mucin. They are filled with mucin. And if someone asks you the special stain, so remember, for mucin, you will remember it is Alcyon blue. These will be positive for Alcyon blue. That is what you need to remember over here. Mucin positive, Alcyon blue positive. So quick recap over here, Barrett's esophagus will show you two different places. One will be the squamous normal epithelium, and you will see a part of it has converted or undergone a metaplasia into columnar epithelium. Which type of columnar epithelium? The intestinal columnar epithelium. And what cells does it contain? The goblet cells. Remember these goblet cells. These goblet cells are going to be considered. This is considered as the hallmark of Barrett's esophagus. This is the hallmark of Barrett's esophagus. That is a question that you get in the exam. What is the hallmark feature of Barrett's esophagus? So till now in pathology, we've done a number of hallmarks, and if I just want to quickly revise them with you. So starting with the very first chapter that we started, that is what was the hallmark of apoptosis, and that was nuclear chromatin condensation. The hallmark of neuronal apoptosis was activation of apoptosis inducing factor. The hallmark of acute inflammation, correct, increased vascular permeability. What was the hallmark of chronic inflammation? Tissue destruction and repair. And what was the hallmark of repair? Correct, granulation tissue. After that, we did a hallmark of malignancy, and that was anaplasia. Now we are doing a hallmark of Barrett's esophagus, which we've done in cell injury, the first chapter as well. And that is the presence of the goblet cells. What do they contain? They contain mucin. And what will they stain positive for? They will stain positive for Alcyon blue. So the one way in which the diagnosis can be made is going to be a biopsy. And remember, that is considered as the gold standard. That is considered as the gold standard. So number one is biopsy. Number two, to do a biopsy, to take a part of the tissue, you will anyway have to do an endoscopy. You will always have to do an endoscopy. And what will you see on endoscopy? You will see red velvety patches. You will see the presence of red velvety patches. Most important finding that you have over here. So for the clinician, when you do an endoscopy, you see red velvety patches which are coming in the lower part of the esophagus. From there, you do a biopsy and you see these two different types of epithelia. You see presence of goblet cells, you see mucin, you can see Alcyon blue positivity, and you know that this particular case is a case of Barrett's esophagus. Once you're done with that, what is the complication that you need to know. And everyone knows from our previous knowledge that there is an increased risk of cancer. Barrett's esophagus is a pre-malignant condition. It is a pre-cancerous condition. So what is Barrett's esophagus? It is a metaplastic process where one epithelium is converting into another epithelium, that is squamous is converting into intestinal. What are the causes? This is happening because of reflux, which can be seen in obese people, overeating, alcohol, smoking, and particularly pregnancy. The diagnosis is always done by an endoscopy where you see red velvety patches followed by a biopsy. The biopsy will show you characteristically two different type of epithelia, squamous and columnar. In between the columnar epithelium, you will see goblet cells. And remember, these cells are considered to be the hallmark feature of Barrett's esophagus. They will stain positive for Alcyon blue. Unfortunately, if you do not treat this patient, the patient will have an increased risk of cancer, which is deadly. And remember, Barrett's esophagus is a metaplastic process. It is reversible. So if treatment is given, this process can be reverted back to normal. These are the key features you need to know about Barrett's esophagus and gastroesophageal reflux disease.